Today I'm creating with Hamamula, and apologies for butchering the pronunciation of their name. I've got their watercolor paper that's pre-cut, and it's sold in a round tin, and you can embellish this tin and do some fun things with it. And in addition to that, I have their watercolor bookmarks. These are nice papers, pre-cut, ready to go, so when you're ready to create and inspiration strikes, they are also ready to go. Now, with them, you can do some fun things. Here is one of the round pieces of paper. You can see I've just added a little bit of color and texture. It's a background ready to go. You can do things like create round doodle designs or mandalas. You can create just a plain old background with a little bit of color and then do some other fun things with it, like I did here with one of Tim's paper dolls, people, whatever they're called, and some wings and some other bits. And then, you know, the shape of the bookmarks is very long and narrow. It's quite rectangular. And I have to admit that I was thinking, oh, okay, watercolor paper in bookmark shape. But the shape of this really forced me to think a little bit differently. In fact, it made me think a lot differently because it's such a narrow, long rectangle. You can use it horizontal or you can use it vertical. And in the video, you're gonna see that I put it together. I put several of them together to create this really cool accordion kind of folded tip-in. You can do so many different things with them. Here, I just did some line work on the background and it's kind of stark and it's very graphic, but I like it a lot. This one is got some numbers on it and this could be done the way that it is. You can take these, you can add them to journal pages. You can stagger them on journal pages. This is that fold out that I mentioned. You can see that I've just hooked it together with some hinges that are actually nothing more than one of my leftover gel prints. I put some color on the back. I can adhere this to the edge of a page and make it a fold out or a tip in or whatever you want to call it. This stuff is really awesome to play with, and let's go take a look at working with it now. The paper that's used for these circles and the bookmarks is 140-pound cold press, and if I hold this up and the light reflects, you can see that like most cold press paper, this is the more smooth side. One side is a little bit smoother than the other. You can use either, it really depends on how much of the pattern you want to see. I've used both and it works out just fine. Now, this tin is metal, so you can use paint on it. You need a multi-surface paint. You could use alcohol ink on it. You could take a finished circle and put it on the top, and now you have this really cool way to display or to store what you've made inside. So this is a fun option too. Now I'll admit that I use an e-reader. So do I really need bookmarks any longer? No, not really, although they make a nice gift if you want to do that for someone. But what I discovered is this long rectangular shape made me think about composition in a way that I don't ordinarily, and it allowed me some choices and some fun things like these. This was just done with a Posca paint pen. All I did was section it off in one way and then just go ahead and make lines in the other. And you can see these are wobbly, they're not perfect, but I think that it's very effective. So this shape I found was a challenge in the beginning, but then the more I played, the more I realized how much fun it actually is to work on. So the rectangles are 2 1/8 by 7 7/8. The circle is 5 1/8 inch in diameter. Now, could you cut these with a die? Yeah, you could, but there's 30 in the tin, and I don't want to stand there cutting 30 of these any more than I want to be slicing these up with a paper cutter, because there's 15 in here. So, things to do with the circles. Well, mandalas and doodling in the round certainly is one option, but another thing that I discovered is that if you go ahead and you score this on two pieces and you attach these, now you have a really cool round card. So I've got some score tape on one side here. It's not quite enough because my score is a little bit wider than a quarter of an inch, but I'm just gonna pull this paper back. Well, now I've got this stuck to my fingers. I'm gonna pull this back and then I'm going to put another piece on and just clip the edge off here, so it doesn't run outside, and if it does, I can always kind of roll it back on itself. And then all I have to do is peel off the backing paper. Let's get this out of the way. Take this and go ahead and line this up, and I'm kind of looking down at it. And remember, score tape is pretty much one and done, so you want to be certain that you're aligned properly. That looks pretty good. And now I have this really cool card that is a circle. So this is from Tim's, let me look at my notes. This is from his, it's here someplace, Blossom Die. And it works. I mean, it's, I could put a sentiment around, I could put a sentiment across. There's lots of different ways to do this. Now, you don't have to leave it white. I did just for the sake of making it easy to demo on. But there's lots of ways to use these round shapes that are very non-traditional, if you will, because I don't see too many round cards as I'm shopping or looking at what folks have made. So, let's talk about paint and color. For everything that I did today, bar this one, I used paint. And so what I've got is one of the circles and one of the bookmarks, and I have a couple colors of Fresco Finish paint. You of course, can use any paint that you want. When I'm working on something this small, I actually like to use a small brayer because it means that I can get parts of color on without overwhelming the piece. This is a Speedball 1.5, and this is a Speedball 2. I'm going to use the 1.5. I've been playing with them both, but for the sake of argument. So I've got three colors of Fresco Finish paint, kind of a yellow, a bright peach, and a violet, and I'm going to start with a lighter color. It doesn't mean anything. I could certainly go back, and I could add more after the fact if I end up overwhelming one of the colors, which I will confess, when I put out as much paint as I just did, does happen. But I like the fact that this is very random. I'm going to get very random looking background, which is exactly what I'm looking for. You know what? I've got enough paint here. I might as well grab another circle and use it. Just get the lid on the tin off, she said. All right, here's another circle. Let's move this like this and go ahead and use some of this. If I've got the paint out, I might as well reuse it. So I'm going up and down and side to side. I'm not really working on the diagonal here. This is a trick that I learned from Leandra at Paper Artsy a long time ago, and I find that I like the way that the backgrounds look when I create them this way. So let's just mop up that yellow, go ahead and put down some of the peach color. Now, when you work with colors like this, I've got orange and purple, which are complementary colors. That means that they exist across the color wheel from one another, and you always get nice pop and nice color when you work like this. Alright, so I definitely have more paint than I need here, even for two of the circles, but we're just going to leave it at this for now. Let's wipe this off and wipe this up and then bring in the purple. Now, when I've been playing around, and certainly when I've used paint at other times, it's easy to work with three. You can certainly bring in more colors if you choose to do that. There's nothing that says that you can't. Oops. I know I'm not going to need as much of the purple. All right, so if I come in here and I start to add some purple highlights, if I think that I've obliterated the yellow too much, it's certainly easy enough to come back and add some more. But for the sake of argument here, I'm going to call this done with this layer. When I get through with filming this segment, then I can always come back and add some more if I want. So that's how simple it is. I really like the small brayer for this because it allows me to get, as I said, some color in places without completely overwhelming the size of that. So up next, hold on 1 second, let's just wipe this off. Up next, I'm going to add some guidelines to circles. I've got one started here. I'm going to show you how I do it, the rest of it in the center. And then I'm going to bring out the bookmarks and talk a little bit more about some fun things that you can do with, well, it would help if that was right set up, some fun things that you can do with that, including putting them together to make someplace here, to make kind of a fold-out or an accordion-style tip-in. And you can do the same thing with these, too. You can make kind of an accordion fold-out. Creating a circle pattern on the paper is as easy as choosing some objects that are about the right diameter. So I started, this is a Speedball 4-inch Baron. I started with that, and that's how I drew my outer circle. And then I came in and I used this really messy, this is a water cup that I use when I'm using paint. I did that. And now I have a bottle of paint. All I have to do, I have a smaller size here, or I can use the bottom, and it's just, this paper is a mess because I managed to get stuff all over it, but this is kind of just for demo purposes. So all I would do would be, and I'm really big about eyeballing, as you know, I generally don't measure very much, I would just go ahead and do this. And so now I have
circles to work from. I could use a pit. This is a Superfine S-tip in black, or I could use a PC1MR, which is what I used here. So once I have my guidelines on, I could do a circle mandala. I could come in and dot a bajillion circles in here, or I could just doodle in the round. For the sake of making it easy today, I'm just going to demo that. I like to start from the outside and work in. Obviously, everybody has their own idea about that. So it can be just really simple things like shapes like this, which ends up making this look like a giant flower when you use shapes like this. Although, depending on what I do with them, it might look less like a flower by the time I make up my mind and I decide what else I'm going to do. Now, you can see I've started off a little bit smaller here and I've gotten bigger. There are bigger things in the world to worry about than whether or not those bumps have gotten a little bit bigger or smaller. But if you notice that they have and you want to correct it, then go ahead. And now I've gotten pointy instead of being round, so I need to remember to go back to being round. But at the end of the day, you're going to look at the whole piece rather than one particular section or element of it. And people are going to look at it and they're going to appreciate it for everything that it is there rather than focusing on one little spot. So let's just, I can get one more in here. And by the time everything is said and done, they all look pretty good together anyway. Now the other thing that I could do would be come in with a heavier marker and make this outline here darker. You can fill things in the way that I did here. Now something worth noting. My black pen burped. I live at elevation. I live at about 3,500 feet, and I didn't mean to, but I did press down enough that I caused the paint to come out of the inside of here. There's a vial in here that holds the paint. And when you press that tip down, it opens the thingy and it allows the paint to flow to the tip. So this was a bigger one, and what happened was it burped right there. And I got a little bit aggravated and I thought, okay, so it really doesn't make any difference. And I'm going to show you why in 1 second. But before I do that, let's talk about how you can string these together. So this becomes very much like an accordion shape. All I did was use some of Dina's sticky back canvas tape and I put it on each piece, and then it's just a question of folding it up. Now, if I wanted this to be a little bit more stable, I could use a wider piece, or I could come back like I did with this card and I could score pieces and make, obviously this is not an accordion style, but I could make this accordion style that way if I wanted to. I think this is a little bit more elegant. I like the way that this looks and I really don't mind that it's not completely stable. So when we talk about a boo-boo like this, there's a couple of different things that you can do. Whoops, let's bring this in. So this is also a Hamamula. I'm going to mispronounce that. This is one of their A5 size journals. This is the bigger of the two. And if I wanted to, if I had a page ready to go, I could put this on this page so that once I trim this, that piece is gone. So don't be discouraged if something like this happens, because there's ways to work around it. The other thing that you could do would be to put something over it the way that I did here. So my thought with this one, and let me just turn this back toward me, my thought with this one is, and I love the way that she looks on this background, is that I could do one of two things. I could either cut this here so that it ends right where the signature is stitched, or I could cut it in such a way that it would allow the signature to open and close without binding up. Six of one, half a dozen of the other. But I think that this round circle makes a really interesting background, especially when you start to pull other elements together and you add pieces to it. All right, so let's switch gears back to the rectangles, because boy, do they fascinate me. So when you talk about accordion pleating things, this one I put together with, this is a leftover piece of a gel print. I save almost everything. They start off sometimes as roll-off sheets, and then I print on top of them. You never know what you're going to get. But I use that, and again, the idea here is that for this one, let's find this page, what I'm going to do, or what I'm thinking about doing, is going ahead and adhering this just like this, so that I'm kind of close to the edge of the page. Whoops, if I could get that there. And then, not only do I have a tip in, but I have one that accordion folds at the same time, which I think is really pretty interesting. I've got colors that kind of coordinate across here, so I think that this works. Now, what I'm going to put on here, I haven't actually decided yet. But when we talk about designing on that long, skinny piece, let's bring these back in. I just am fascinated by these, and my initial thought was, oh, these are cool, we can use them in a variety of ways, until I started to play with them, and I realized how much I liked working in this format, because it forced me to think in a way, normally I might work on 4x6 or 6x9 or something that is not as narrow as this, but it gives you opportunities to do things that you might not ordinarily. So I put some color on here. This is our Raggedy Holes stencil. I used that here. I put some more color on the background, and then I took the birds. This is Marlene's. This is her Owlicious stamp set. Sorry, there's glare there. All I did was just stamp them and cut them out. I put a little bit of stickles on there that worked with that peach color in the background, and I stacked them up, and it makes for silly things. Excuse me, silly things. Things that I wouldn't necessarily ordinarily think to do. And kind of the same thing here with this, although I mentioned this earlier. This one, I just thought, let me do something really line worky on there that I don't ordinarily do, because when I doodle, much like this, they tend to be more round or curved shapes. But this one has nothing round or curvy about it. These are elements from one of Marlene's die cut blocks, and these are some of her sayings from her sticky quotes. This one is a whole different kettle of fish. I kept wondering what I could do vertically here, and I wanted some bold elements, but ones that were stamped. And so I grabbed, this is Tim's numeric stamp set, and I grabbed some stamps and I did this. Now I will say that this is Ranger's archival ink, and I find that if I want to dot, and I've got one here that kind of disappeared, if I want to dot, I find that the dots stand up better on that ink. Once it's dry, I put a really thin layer of gel medium on it, and that allowed me to get nice white dots against that black. So when we look at this, again, I've got the number 3, and I've got archival ink, and I have one spot left here that I want to go ahead and stamp on. And so I just want something, you know what, let me grab this journal. I just want something with a little bit of a cushion so that I can, well, let's do it this way, so that I can go ahead and stamp this. What I did was I put paint on here. This is another strip of a gel print. This is on the Yasutomo rice paper. And then I cut it, or I tore it, so that I had a white edge, and I came back and I just stained it with some spray stains. So all I want to do now is put the number 3 on here, kind of like this. And then I have some other things that I want to put on it. So again, archival, oops, I hope if I was doing that the right way. I'm gonna grab, this is just a piece. This is a piece of wet strength tissue that I've been playing around with. It's just got some color braid off on it for now. I don't want to get black ink on that page spread that I'm working on, because I know I'm not going to probably want that, just that smudge that's going to be right in the middle. But this gives me a little bit of cushion. So I'm going to put this down, go ahead and eyeball my 3. And now I know I can stamp it off the edge without having to worry about making a mess on the page that's there. So let's just put that like that. Now, archival is an oil-based ink, and so it does take a couple of minutes to dry. I'm going to ignore the fact that this is not dry and hope it doesn't bite me in the butt. So once I've got this on here, okay, there's my number 3. Let's get that out of the way and this out of the way. Put the cover on the ink pad. Do yourself a favor, buy a reinker. There's nothing worse than trying to work with an ink pad that just doesn't have any juice left in it. So now what I'm going to do, and I probably won't glue this in place, I'm going to put another one of Marlene's elements on here, and then I'm going to grab a whole bunch of quotes from, this is the Small Talk sticker set, and I'm going to use the black ones because I like the way that it works against the black, and then I'm going to line these above and below her, and I'll probably not center her because direct center doesn't generally work as well. I like something that's a little bit off-center. I'll put those sticky quotes in there, and then she'll be done. So whether you use these as a bookmark, or you create something accordion style, like I did, if I could actually put my hands on it, but it's here someplace, or you make an accordion style book out of the circles, there's just a whole bunch of different ways that you can create with, well, I don't know where the cover is, that you can create with these wonderful round circles or these bookmarks.